Well, good morning. Morning, everyone. Good morning. Lovely to see everybody. On my bedside table at home, I have this coaster. You can't read it, I know, from there. But it says on it, "In everything, give thanks." 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 18. And I've had it a long time. I can't even remember where I got it from. Might have been a present, but it does remind me, when I have my morning cup of tea, to give thanks. And that's what we want to think about this morning, giving thanks, because difficult times that we're living in at the moment, it's easy to let that slide. It's easy to forget to do that. So this particular reading, 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 18, I'm going to just expand slightly on it. I've given everybody copies of the readings for today. It's on the top one. And this is what it actually says in the Word, starting to read from verse 16 to 20. Well, we're going from 16 to 24. Verse 16, "Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances. For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus." And of course, as I've just said, that's not always an easy thing to do. Give thanks in all circumstances. "Do not quench the spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through, and may your whole soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." And then this verse at the end, 24, "The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it." And when I read that, what that tells me is that it is hard, yes, sometimes to give thanks in all circumstances. It is hard to be upbeat and positive when things are hard and difficult. But as verse 21 tells me, the God who calls me to do these things is faithful, and he will help me to do that. It's not all down to me. I know that the Spirit in me is there to work, and he will help me. And we're just going to have one other reading, and then we're going to listen to a song. Psalm 100, and I've headed this up, a psalm for giving grateful praise, because that's to me what it sounded like when I read it. "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness and come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. So enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever, and his faithfulness continues throughout all generations." Now, the video we're going to watch now is a recording of that lovely song, "Give Thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever." The singer is Chris Tomlin. Forever you are with us, and forever you are strong. And Lord, forever you are with us. And that is something to be so thankful about. We're going to look now at Psalm 145. It's another great psalm, another great psalm of praise. There's so many psalms of praise in the Old Testament, wonderful psalms. And we're going to look through this later when we have the prayer and sharing time. It might be that you find a line in this psalm or in the preceding readings that you want to claim as your own, that you might want to be thankful for, to talk about when we share together. But first of all, now we'll just read this, Psalm 145. I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works. They tell of the power of your awesome works, and I will proclaim your great deeds. They celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made. All your works praise you, Lord. Your faithful people extol you. They tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might, so that all people may know of your mighty acts and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations. The Lord is trustworthy in all he promises and faithful in all that he does. The Lord upholds all who fall and lifts up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food at the proper time. You open your hand and you satisfy the desires of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways, and he is faithful in all that he does. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desires of those who fear him. He hears their cry and saves them. The Lord watches over all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth will speak in praise of the Lord. Let every creature praise his holy name forever. Well, there's an awful lot in there that speaks of the greatness of God, the marvelness of God, the wonder of the Lord, and there's a lot in there that we can thank him for and be aware of that he's doing in our lives. So Nigel is going to come out now and he's going to give the message for this morning. Thank you.
Morning. Let's just pray, shall we? Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to gather here together in your place, in your name. And I ask you now, Father God, to bless me as I try and put over the words that I prepared, which I have sought you for. And I ask you, Father God, to open all our ears, that whatever phrase or words you would have us take on board, that you would enable us to do that. Lord, and even now, that you would change the words I speak if they need changing, Father God. In Jesus' name, we ask this of you. Thank you. I know I'm not alone in feeling that something is somehow lacking in our current services. I know all our worship leaders have struggled, having to prepare services without being able to include singing, or at least not being able to sing freely. I know Sharon struggles, and I know Steve and Val struggle. I don't know if it's partly a cultural thing, a habit we've gotten into, but singing God's praise seems to be a core part of our worship. To be told that you can't sing, like we have been, seems like there is some external authority with an agenda to restrict the worship of God. I don't actually believe, humanly speaking, that's necessarily the case at this time, but that's how it feels. Sharon and myself were discussing this a few weeks ago. Sharon was trying to prepare a time of worship and she was really struggling. We were specifically talking about how restricted praise and worship felt when we couldn't sing. Elsa, our daughter, came into the room partway through the conversation and was listening until the point where she welled up with indignation on God's behalf. She has a habit of doing that. I don't always agree with everything Elsa says, but I have learnt to listen. I know she has a close walk with God. Her eyes were filling up, and she was clearly upset that we felt our ability to praise God was in some way impaired just because we couldn't sing. How could that be? How could we allow that to be? It stopped our conversation. Not really knowing what to say, appreciating that what she has said was obviously right, but not changing the reality of how we felt. It was a valid challenge. I don't have the answer, by the way, before I go any further. I don't actually think there is a corporate answer. Worship, true worship, is a very personal thing. It has to be. It's what springs from a personal, one-to-one relationship with God. We do it corporately, but it's not really a corporate thing. But the current situation is a bit of a wake-up call to us all as to how we worship. What is worship? What makes worship worship? I want to share with you something I heard a while ago, something that struck me as deeply profound. I was watching a documentary on Alan Bennett, the author and playwright. I don't know if any of you are familiar with Alan Bennett or his writings. He's an Oxford University educated, acclaimed actor and playwright from a northern working class background. I think he must be in his 80s now. His work may not be to your taste, but I think he has done some very thought-provoking, insightful stuff. In reality, I know very little about him or his character, but he comes over as modest and humble with a social conscience. He was talking about his background. He was apparently at one point an active Anglican, but sadly he gradually moved away from the church and now considers himself to be an agnostic. I looked up the definition of an agnostic just for the avoidance of doubt. It's the view that the existence of God is unknown or unknowable. It simply means that a man cannot say he knows or believes in the existence of a divine creator if he has no scientific grounds to back up his belief. I suppose it's a bit like doubting Thomas. Unless I see for myself, I can't believe. To extend that and put it differently, beyond its actual definition, there is no personal relationship there. There can't be, because you don't even know the other person actually exists. Listening to him talk, he was clearly aware that he had moved out of a relationship that he had had with God. And then he said this, something I found very profound. He said that what he really missed about knowing God was having someone to thank. I want to repeat that, because if you take nothing else from this message, I want you to take those words. And if the significance of them passes you by, I would ask you to take them home with you and consider them prayerfully. He said what he really missed about knowing God was having someone to thank. That, for me, goes right to the heart of worship. For me, being thankful to God, is the heart of our worship. Being aware of all that God has done for us in our salvation, all the good things he has blessed us with, and constantly blesses us with, should result in a deep, strong inner desire to thank him almost constantly. Such thankfulness comes from a spirit-given knowledge that through what Jesus has done for us, we are indeed children of God. Without genuine thankfulness, our faith is nothing more than a hollow religious practice. Humanly speaking, of course, thankfulness doesn't always come easily. Life has a habit of throwing stuff at us that can make us anything but thankful. Some people, it seems to me, are never thankful. And some think, it seems to me, that thankfulness is a sign of weakness or dependency. Having started to think about this, it struck me odd that thankfulness is not listed as a fruit of the Spirit. But I think perhaps there are some things that God hopes to see in us that are from our heart, from within us ourselves, and not the result of a prompting of the Holy Spirit. Isn't it reasonable for God to receive our thankfulness expressed freely and unprompted? There are times in life when everything seems good, and thankfulness comes easily. There are times in life where things are not good, but though we find ourselves overwhelmed, we still feel God's presence and recognize his provision. But there are also times when we have to admit when things are not good, and we find ourselves completely overwhelmed, and we struggle to see or know God in our circumstances. Scripture is full of the ups and downs of life. The Psalms in particular are a real reflection on the roller coaster of human experience. Psalm 69, just one possible example amongst many. The writer cries out, "Save me, O God, for the floodwaters are up to my neck. Deeper and deeper I sink into the mire. I can't find a foothold. I am in deep water, and the floods overwhelm me. I am exhausted from crying for help. My throat is parched. My eyes are swollen with weeping, waiting for God to help." How desperate is that? Unfortunately, there is a risk that if you or I to express a similar sense of despair in some Christian company, we could be made to feel a bit of a weak Christian spiritual failure for not living an adequately victorious life, or some other such terminology. But we are given such scriptures for a purpose. They accurately reflect some aspects of our physical and emotional life. Jesus lived a human life. He understands anything that we may go through. Thankfulness cannot be a hollow words-only ritual. It has to be there in every circumstance of our lives. Our worship of God, our praise, cannot be situation dependent. It cannot be subject to the ups and downs of life. There are times when thankfulness just flows, but there are also times when it has to be an act of will. And we need to understand that when times are good, so that we can exercise it when times are bad. Psalm 23, probably one of the best known psalms, has a lot to say about the different circumstances we find ourselves in life. It starts off well, doesn't it? Life is good. The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. He lets me rest in green meadows. He leads me beside peaceful streams. He renews my strength. When things are going well for us and times are good, it should be easy to be thankful. And yet it seems to me that it's very often the time when we forget to be thankful. We forget that all our blessings are from God. We just take everything for granted and don't turn to God until we need something else. We need something else from him. But these opening words of the psalm speak in great simplicity about the comfort and protection of God, something we should be eternally thankful for. But of course, times are not always good. The stuff of life rears its ugly head often. We can find ourselves in some very dark places, either physical, emotional, or spiritual. But we need to stand firm in the knowledge that God is still there with us. And therefore, thankfulness should still be a very real part of our response to God, even or especially in our really dark places. As Psalm 23 continues, even when I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me. Your rod and your staff comfort and protect me. We need to be very thankful for that. I think verse 5 is wonderful. You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. Father God prepares a table for you personally, a feast, right in front of your enemies, in full view, right in their face, a victory feast. Who are your enemies? Well, I don't know necessarily in your particular case. I only know my own, and they change. I don't believe it's referred to people, literal enemies. Although in certain circumstances, I don't see why not. I think it's more likely referring to your dark places, your fears, maybe your failings or your addictions, those things that would bind you, cancer, depression, whatever they are, however overwhelmed by them you feel, you can be thankful that you do have the victory over them through Jesus. And the Father shows you that. He declares it publicly by preparing a table before you in the face of them. The Hebrew word for prepare means to arrange, set in order, ordain. Ordain means to establish or order by appointment, decree or law. God is ordaining something special for you. He is setting things in place for you in an orderly, controlled way. It may not seem it, but everything is under control. God's control. He prepares provision for you, a feast, right in front of those things that trouble or oppress you, your enemies. God is not daunted by any trouble or evil. He sustains you when you're under attack. The feast is for you and you alone. The darkness cannot approach it. It can only look on. You sometimes have to wipe away the tears and look for God in your circumstances. But he is always there. Thankfulness sometimes is easy, but it is always an act of will. Many of the songs we sing, usually, reflect our thankfulness, but some hit home more than others. Unfortunately, we can sometimes be too heavily influenced by the tune. Sometimes it's a bit too easy to sing such words of significance. One of the many that helped me worship is "Bless the Lord, O my soul," or 10,000 reasons. It's a very thankful song, but it also provokes self-analysis. One of the verses particularly should challenge us. Verse 2 reads, "The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes." Just to state the obvious, "let me be singing when the evening comes" is not a hope that the day won't upset me and that we're still happy in the evening. The words are a statement of intent to praise God regardless of what the day brings. There is an act of will involved on our part to still sing praise, to still be thankful at the end of a day, regardless of what trouble we may have had. But we are not alone in this. Those last two lines to me, "let me be singing when the evening comes," are not just a statement. They are also a prayer for help. "Even when I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. You honour me with blessing. My cup overflows with blessing. Surely your goodness and unfailing love will pursue me all the days of my life." Singing helps us to express our thankfulness. Song facilitates praise in a very real and genuine way. After all, many of the Psalms are meant to be sung. But what really matters is the words we are singing, and do we really mean them? To sing them is wonderful, but the actual act of worship is in the owning of the words. When you sing words of praise, do you own them? Do you sing them as if you wrote them yourself? As if they are your own personal words to your Lord and Saviour, and only your words? If so, then our meditation on them, or our speaking, not singing, of those words in prayer or silent reflection, should be as much an act of worship as when we sing them. We may be unable to sing at the moment as we are used to in our corporate worship, and we may feel the effect of that. But our true worship is not dependent upon singing. Our true worship is dependent upon a grateful and a thankful heart.
Thank you, Nigel. Thank you. So in a few moments, we've swapped things around a little bit this morning. You've probably noticed. We've swapped things around because Nigel wanted to really have the prayer and sharing time at the end as a way, really, of you acknowledging what he talked about. Just, you know, the prayer and sharing time, maybe to have the opportunity just for us as an act of will to talk with each other. On video as well, if you want to, but unless you come up and use the lectern, of course, it's not going to be on the video. So it can be private, it can be just amongst us. But to have the opportunity just to pray and to perhaps share some things that you're thankful for, something maybe from some of the readings today, something which perhaps in the message really spoke to you. And of course also, not just only to be thankful, but to pray about people who need our prayers, need God's help. So before we have that time of prayer and sharing, I'm going to sing a song. Not really ever sure if we're supposed to be doing this or not, but I'm quite a long way from the front row. And I'm going to sing, "Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ his Son." That's something to be thankful for to begin with. That is perhaps the most important thing to be thankful for. And we'll then have that time of prayer and sharing.
Thank you.
Give
thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ His Son. And now let the weak say I am strong. Let the poor say I am rich because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say I am strong. Let the poor say I am rich because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ His Son. Now let the weak say I am strong. Let the poor say I am rich because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say I am strong. Let the poor say I am rich because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks. Now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich because of what the Lord has done for me. Father God, we thank You for all that You have done for us. We thank You for sending Jesus. We thank You, Jesus, that You came and that You died in our place. And we thank You, Lord, here this morning that there is so very, very much to thank You for. And now we're going to just spend a little bit of time, perhaps in silence, but hopefully not in silence, praising You and sharing with each other, those of us here in the church anyway, those things that we are grateful for today, those things that You have done for us. Thank You, Lord. Amen.
Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before Him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. For the Lord is good, and His love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. I would like just to pick up on the quote from Alan Bennett that Nigel just mentioned, and that he said he missed having someone to thank. I have heard that before, that he missed having someone to thank. And it just struck me, why would that be? Why does it matter? Because whatever it is that God gives us, whether it's a solution to a difficult circumstance, whether it's our everyday needs, whether it's, you know, just our food, our shelter, our relationships, our families, whatever it is that God's giving to us, the fact that we understand that God is giving it to us changes it from a chance circumstance to a gift given in love, because he loves us. That's why it matters that we have someone to thank.
I'm going to have that song now, which Nigel mentioned in his message, 10,000 Reasons, or Bless the Lord, All My Soul. This version is a lovely version, and it's sung by Matt Redman. And I know we can't really stand up and sing along enthusiastically, but we can sing behind our masks, and we can sing in our hearts, and we can sing praises to God, and we can thank him for all that he's done for us. And that's as an act of will, if necessary. Thank you, Nigel.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never. Worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing. When the evening comes, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul, worship his holy. Oh,
Yes. Sometimes it's an act of will to thank God. Sometimes it's easy. Sometimes it's just there and you just can't help but overflow with praise. But sometimes it is an act of will. And sometimes it just starts with thinking of one thing to thank him for. And then another thing. And then another thing. And before you know it, you're really praising God. And it's been lovely this morning just standing at the back and actually seeing people standing and praising God, thanking God. Wonderful. Thank you. Let's just close now with the grace to each other, shall we? So may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.